Hello and welcome to part two of our interview with Lydia White Calf. If you haven't watched part one, turn this off and go back and watch part one because you'll be totally amazed and you'll be well informed. We're interviewing Lydia and she's got a deep look down the rabbit hole. So if you're just new to this awakening, this may be confusing. If you've been down there as long as we have, and I know a lot of my subscribers have, you'll be amazed with this interview. We're going to pick up where we left off. We did some historical references on the plight of the American Indians, and now the plight of us, the people that are awake enough to watch World Beyond Belief. And now we're going to look into Lydia's story and how that unfolded. I'm sure you'll be fascinated. Hi, Lydia. How are you?
Hi, Paul. Thank you. I'm fine. Thank you. Good to see you again.
Good.
Thank you for this opportunity.
It's our pleasure. It's definitely our pleasure.
Thank you. I'm really grateful. So, okay. Well, I had stated that in hindsight, the day I met Royce, and there's plenty of evidence from my personal experience, more than enough, that's when the surveillance began.
And okay, now, just for the people who haven't bothered to watch part one, Royce is your husband.
Royce White Calf is full-blood Oglala Lakota from the Pine Ridge Indian Reservation, which is the historic band of Crazy Horse and Red Cloud. And actually, I became really good friends before I met Royce with the great-great-grandson of Red Cloud, Oliver. He became one of my best friends. He was about 30-some years older than I was and was with him till 3 days before he died. And he did come flaring down to Naropa at one point, but that's another story. So I don't want to get ahead of myself. But you know, as you can see, it's I arrive with a sense of humor when I'm born, and I think that's a big part of you know, my survival tactics. I just can't. It's not that there hasn't been bad moments and really dark, hard stuff. The hardest, the darkest. But I'll somehow find a way to start laughing in the middle of it because that's kind of how I arrived when I was born. And I think that really is my best defense. And it's also an offense because that's one thing I want to share. So if I start laughing a lot, because I know I saw Catherine Horton yesterday telling you in the telling the audience in the Techno Crime Fighters Forum that you guys see me looking strong and together, and you're asking, but you're under, you know, assassination attempts and fire. And she said, what same thing I'm gonna say. You know, Bob Marley had an expression, you don't know how strong you are until there's no option. Until there's no other option. And I had no idea how strong I was when there was no other option. It was either that or death for, you know, the better part of 17 years, any given day. So again, I arrive in 1993 on two projects. I'm at that time, you know, well-respected and known photojournalist globally. And I worked for international press, including the New York Times, the Miami Herald, Hong Kong, South China Sea, sorry. It's been a long time. Morning Post, Hong Kong Morning Post, and the giant, you know, newspaper for Southeast Asia, and a lot smaller newspapers, the Jakarta Post, the Bangkok Post, global magazines, etc. So I am forming two in-depth long-term projects at this stage in my life, which lead me to Pine Ridge Indian Reservation, whereupon I meet a guy called Royce White Calf, and that was October 1993. I hate to say he was a guy, but my niece used to call him a stud muffin, but you know, he's a really beautiful guy. And so I'll call him a stud muffin. I marry him the following June 1994, on the anniversary of Custer's death. And we lived together for just short of a full year in Pine Ridge. And the reason we were forced to leave Pine Ridge, I now understand, because of documentation online, especially with the George Webb phenomenon, the video series and the websites that George Webb is bringing forward, the honest elements inside, left inside government, who give us all the documents, that I can no longer question that the custody suit put on me for my daughter, which lasted 6 years, from a father that we hadn't seen since she was born. And that was the result of a date rape. I'll say that proudly, because I would not have anything to do with that man in any other circumstance. But I was 27 and ready to have a child, and there was something about this. You know, I wanted her, and married him for legitimacy. My parents told me I had to, which I should have known better than to follow their rules at the age of 27. But
well, this wasn't Royce.
No. So the daughter I arrive with when I meet him is 5. Her name is Sophia. She was just the most incredible, magical, beautiful child in this world. And this custody suit literally arrives for the day I'm going to marry him. And that's the first indication we're under attack. I can see now in hindsight, because the stress of being dragged through a 6-year custody suit and the visitations, the drives to the airport while I'm bearing 2 babies along the way, all 3 C-sections, and in full-time student in Europa, the only driver in the family till 3 years ago, my plate was already full without the custody suit. The custody suit caused me to appear in court by phone 300-400 times. Those two knuckleheads were finally thrown out of that courtroom by the judge on the 6th year, when it became evident that there was sexual abuse happening to my daughter by the stepmother, who's worth $100 million. And it had been told to me, he was a drug dealer from South America. And I would never insult Scarface by comparing that thing to Scarface. But he was just the most despicable. And it was a rape, and I'm quite sure, because there's evidence now that he was busted. He was bringing in huge amounts of cocaine from Bolivia, the blocks. He and his 3 brothers decided to find a rich town in America and service it for their coke business. And I grew up in that very town. I grew up in the richest county in America and in the richest town in that county, which is Greenwich, Connecticut. And Royce and I are always proud to say I grew up in the richest county and he grew up in the poorest, because there's no 2 people more alike on earth. And he managed my family somewhat well, and they didn't manage him very well. I hear in hindsight, but he was so wonderful. Who could not love Royce? So the custody suit begins and puts our marriage into stress the day we get married. and on unbelievable levels, and my life in distress. And of course, that's counterintelligence. And going back to there's evidence that David Ferreira was busted in this cocaine business. About the time I met him, I'd come home for Christmas from Singapore. And I was at a party and I got raped. Long story short. And by this animal. And I got pregnant. And I haven't met Royce yet. This was in 1986 or 1987. The point being, he was busted. And he was making a couple $100,000 a year, being the coke boy to the rich kids in Greenwich. They already had him. This is what I learned is the prison recruit system from the documents presented by George Webb, now available online. Also really highlighted in this book, which is reviewed by one U.S. senator as one of the most important book of our time. It's written in 1989. And it's reviewed by another CIA agent, John Quires, U.S. House of Representatives, says this book deals with one of the most important issues in our constitutional democracy and is one of the most important contributions to the subject yet written. So, this is a really important book. I guess these books came along with Royce, and there's a lot I did read, a lot of political books I did read, but some of them, trauma stopped me from going there. So I didn't read this till this last week. And lo and behold, because when I showed this book, and I finally opened it 4 years ago, and I open it to where it's been so well worn, it opens up to these words, Operation Garden Plot. I have a heart attack because Royce used to, we'd go on the radio or wherever he went, he did a lot of public speaking his first years in Boulder. He was on demand everywhere. He would bellow, Operation Garden Plot. And I used to have a theory starting 4 years ago. That was the problem. We've been trying to figure this out forever. What caused this? This being termed by two Delta Force bodyguards of Steven Seagal's that were sent to our property in 1998, now in the mountains, just down the road from this house. And I'll elucidate for the audience how many times we moved and where this started. But they deemed when this became full blown. We are now under special operations warfare, literally. Steven Seagal arrives and tries to help us and sends us his two best bodyguards, which is saying a lot. They had just stepped off the helicopter the day before from the Gulf, in between Gulf Wars. They were Delta Force, as I've explained in the first video. That's JSOC. Current, that they're who dropped the bomb yesterday on Afghanistan, the mother of all bombs, Syria, Libya, Iraq, everywhere, Somalia, Sudan. they were triggered into military action phase on this family in when we returned from a tribunal in Vancouver, Canada, in June 1998. I hope I haven't confused everyone too much. I'm married.
Let me interject. Now, the first, the father of your daughter was a drug dealer that might have gotten turned by the CIA to become your first stalker.
Yes. Yes. No question. Events and documents are available on that. Not only that, he announced to me within the first year of the custody suit, this was a money deal. And the papers they presented to the judge in Palm Beach County, he's the father of the year. I'm the flaky idiot, mentally retarded mom. You name it. You know what they do. And The woman who is a total stranger, who's worth $100 million or something like that. She's an heiress, a Palm Beach heiress, who's just the most unbearable sort of creature. This is her second boyfriend, and she was 51 at the time. This is her second. She had no problem with this South American, you know, slicked back. She seemed to be proud of him. They're still together. He's on hire. She pays him to pose as father to their two children, which she spent $500,000 seminally incepting. That they're not natural. So she could put my daughter in the middle of two sets of brothers for life, and my daughter would have two mothers by blood. And you know, this was pretty criminal of the FBI, of the CIA. This is just criminal to do this to human beings. So that's where it starts. Before, this is still the surveillance counterintelligence that I deem is, this is, you know, this isn't even foreplay. I'm not even aware that Royce and I have caused any kind of problem to anybody. So this period lasts from 1993. We moved to Boulder. Again, we're married in 1994 in Pine Ridge. We lived there together for a year with Sophia. We're hounded by the father and the whatever creature thing he married, literally showing up at every driveway since. Stalked to the point, there's no word. She is beyond a psychopath, a stalker of wanting to be Lydia White Calf. She's obsessed with who I am to the point of trying to get in the bed that I grew up in my father's house. Mother's house this whole time, still sending my mother, you know, love Helen. They got divorced 17 years ago, and she still sends my mother, you know, packages and presents 10 times a year. It's a tick you can't lose, that the woman that comes with the, that they arranged, I'm sure at this point, because a bust happened in Greenwich, Connecticut in 1987. I only find out about 6 or 7 years ago because he ends up in prison. 7 years ago, that the father of my child, Sophia, David Ferrer, ends up in prison because now he, being married to Helen for this money deal, even if they're in the divorce stage, the deal was, she said to him, so the story goes, I'll buy you any toy in the world. You can have Bentleys. This is a guy from poverty, equal to Pine Ridge. I went there to Brazil with him. Poverty. He also grew up without electricity and water. Poverty. So she says, any toy. And sure enough, you know, I'm hearing stories when I'm now in Pine Ridge from Palm Beach, from friends saying, Lydia, I just saw David go by in a Bentley that's a convertible with a cigar in his mouth with a, you know, the Panama hat. And, you know, and he had a collection of motorcycles, every toy and world travel. And suddenly he's a skier. And I was a skier. I was a real skier from birth. At 2 years old, I skied behind the U.S. team. I was an athlete. I also rode at the garden. Some of my other, you know, I rode under the, I was trained by Bill Steinkraus, who's the captain of the United States equestrian team. So in both those areas, I was associated with the Olympic team. And he's now riding horses, buying horses. He's now skiing.
So you didn't go to Brazil with him, though?
On our honeymoon. My parents forced me to marry him. I went down there for 3 months.
He was from Brazil?
Yes, he's from São Paulo. And his brother, who was Navy Intel, His older brother's Navy intelligence based in Germany. This is, you know, is during the 70s. His brother's Navy intelligence based out of Berlin. I knew that all along. It just didn't have significance until, you know, I start realizing at this level what's been going on. So his brother was also perpetrating psychological abuse, and it is on record in Palm Beach County that he raped my child, Sophia, when we lived there when she was three. It's on record. I was good friends with a policeman. People respected me and loved me wherever I went because I love people wherever I go. So the police came to me, and I was really good friends with this one officer, and I told him about the strange behavior of David's brother taking Sophia out on dates. And I was clueless back then. And he said, Lydia, we have to talk. He was really close to me. He knew what was going on. This is long before I meet Royce. But so there's already a situation set up that, you know, right there for the FBI by the time I marry Royce with my ex-husband, his evil older brother that lives in Brazil that organized the drugs from South America. Not quite Scarface level. They made hundreds and hundreds of thousands a year. Three brothers. So David decided, I later learned, that he wanted a Greenwich girl. But there was a special one he wanted. The unique one. So he raped me. So that's David. And they really... The last I've seen or heard of them is was recently as 3 years ago. It took to lose those two. And they come in at, you know, this starts in 1993 with them. And they have made my life an unholy nightmare. And the agents come through them throughout the web of my story. And I don't want to take too much more time on them, but during the 6 years of those forced visitations, which are 3.5 downtown. We move to the mountains. When we get back from the tribunal, 8 months later. And that's what I call, so the story starts in Pine Ridge, Boulder, the Boulder years, 1995 to 1999. What I call Mountain House One, which is 1999 to 2001. That's where we had everything but the tanks. Flee to Santa Fe, Mexico. That's an important part of this story. Return and buy this house exactly 10 years ago. So buy this house in 2007. And the let me pause for a minute and say that I've organized the story from 1998 because of the tribunal I was a juror at until currently in three phases. Phase one is downtown and Mountain House One. That's what I call a military nightmare from hell. Phase two, it's Santa Fe, 6 years in Santa Fe, and I call that the occult nightmare from hell. Phase three, this house, Mountain House Two, 2007 to 2000 to today, 17. Phase three is occult and military nightmare from hell. So those three phases. And I haven't counted, I've drawn a map. I've mapped this out about 2 months ago. I've gotten proactive all of a sudden. And so I began this process before I happened upon your first video, Paul, when I first got, I'd already started turning it around, the energy of this around where I'm becoming proactive and not seeing myself as a victim anymore. And where I've decided for myself, this ends here. I will tell all the visiting agents watching this video goodbye. Because we're going to, you know, take legal action and every kind of action to ensure that you just leave us alone. I don't want any money. I'm not looking to sue, but I'm done. My sons are done because there's only three of us left living. It's not that my daughter's dead, but she's not. She's so utterly psychiatrically destroyed and programmed to kill me. That's hard to believe, but. Maybe at this point I could move to the map.
That's not sure. I want to make sure people know that you're in the middle of this. Yes, you could call yourself a victim for a while, but you were a real player when it comes to the Kevin Annette deception, the tribunal deception. I'm surprised that with West Palm Beach and child molestation, we didn't hear Jeffrey Epstein.
Well,
which probably weaves in here somewhere.
I'm not doubting that.
I'm not doubting it either. But no. What you're going to see coming up here, just to give the viewers a little insight.
Okay, so
the story unfolds. It involves so many deceptive agents that we need to recognize as deception agents, and how they've interacted with Lydia, and why she's in the middle of this, and why information from her is invaluable. So hang on to your seats. Here we go to the chart on the wall. Here we go.
All right.
Yeah, we were blown away when we first saw this. It's not a piece of artwork, but you'll be surprised at all the connections and all the people that are involved here. As we go, we're going to try to move in and then allow the thing to focus. Okay, so here we go.
How's it doing?
It's doing well.
Okay. All right.
Okay.
So there's three levels. That's the first. Do I need to go through that again?
Well, I think we've done a little bit in the first about how you got involved with your husband and how they were constantly haranguing you, and finally they basically took him out without taking him out.
Yeah, I watched them murder him.
Being
the last 6 months he was here, he was being murdered in front of me. But anyway, we started Pine Ridge in 1993. These are
read some off for us.
Read some of them?
Yeah, read some because we can't really read them.
Okay. So the main important people in Pine Ridge that continue to be involved into the current, Cornell Conroy, who announces he's the head CIA agent for Pine Ridge Indian Reservation. I had a very incredible encounter with him. I'll tell you about in 2000, in a kidnapping. I was kidnapped. So that's Cornell Conroy. And I'm sure he doesn't mind. It's probably online that he's CIA. He's Indian and he wears fatigues and he has a military crop haircut, but he's Lakota. That's the goons. A Sam Moves camp played heavily in that kidnapping. He's a very famous medicine man, especially back to the AIM wounded knee days. Aaron Running Hawk, he is the premier, he was the premier black magician I'd never heard of, sorcerer, that kidnaps me. He's naval intelligence. all the photos of him in his mother's house are in his military uniform, Vietnam. So we know he's naval, and he announces it. Naval, so ONI. Royce's ex-wife, Roberta Ecofee, who I'm not in any way trying to hurt, her brother becomes the head federal marshal for the Wounded Knee episode and is still in that office. So what a federal marshal, which is Joint Terrorism Task Force, BIA, CIA, that's her brother. She plays a prominent role in making sure Royce dies, along with his sister, Sandra Bellion, whose husband perpetrated a very, very famous political assassination of a man called Brian DeSersa, who started a newspaper during the Wounded Knee days. It was my brother, Lonnie Goon, that murdered him. So that's as far as there's one more here. The son of a brewer, one of the worst families of perpetrating the bloodbath in Wounded Knee, are the Brewer family. So his cousin shows up in Boulder. And I'm going to go diagonally down because we move from Pine Ridge to Boulder and get this crowd around us in 1995. So are you seeing visually okay the Boulder?
We can see what's going on.
Okay.
I want to remind them, the people that are watching this, is that when she became a target, she was surrounded by agents. People that are new to this target individual, it's hard to get your head around the amount of people and money and resources that are allocated to stalking and torturing each member. Each TI. So what we're showing here is as she moves from place to place, how her tormentors, mostly CIA or intelligence agencies, show up and do these various things. Do you want to describe your kidnapping?
Yeah, let me finish this map without too much detail.
Okay.
And I'll highlight just the most key players. The most key players, Walter Leon Hill. And I'm going to read something when I get back to my desk about him offline. He was Office of Navy Intelligence again, ONI. The other major key player, Kevin Annette, the supposed priest from Canada. And I'll fill in after I get back to my desk. Jim Craven, who I believe is a knock. That's non-officially covert agent. That's not a real name, not a real identity. Now, he's at the highest levels because I've researched for over a year in his identity of the DOJ, Washington. And I've been trailed by these IP addresses. So we've got Jim Craven, who comes to the tribunal. I meet Kevin and Jim, and I'll explain the tribunal when I get back to my desk in 1998. They're introduced to me through the tribunal. I come home to needing an attorney the next day when I get back from the tribunal, and Walter Lee Hill shows up to be that attorney. He's Special Operations CIA. Wolf has been planted in our life since the second week we arrived. When we moved to Boulder, he's still tracking me around Netherland to this day, of course. He's been through the whole thing. He's prison recruit. His real name is Scott Potter. Ward Churchill, DOJ, he was doing the assassination himself of the Black Panthers, including Fred Hampton, as evidenced by a video to the Real News Network 3 years ago, where he admits he was at the door when 200 bullets were emptied into Fred Hampton. So There were lesser players. Steven Seagal enters. We know he's CIA. Eagle Cruz is FBI. He's the phony teacher at Naropa. It was a giant entrapment scheme for me somehow. And Russell Means, who I'm not gonna make any public announcements, but I know that, and Royce knows that, he was sent to receive the arms and train the Contras in Iran-Contra, our famous Russell Means. So I leave that up to everyone else. Aaron Running Hawk, the black sorcerer that kidnapped and raped me for 3 weeks, that destroyed Royce. And here we have a connection back with Pine Ridge. This leads us to flee 3 years into it to Santa Fe. This is phase two, a cult nightmare from hell. And you can see there's a lot of players here. And these are mostly the criminal underworld and serial killers and murderers. Also, I might add that Wolf was a murderer and was in Fort Leavenworth for 10 years. So we have this repeating pattern of murderers. And there's another one down here that I'll explain in a minute. Enter Seth Leach. He becomes my daughter's boyfriend when he's 12. I say today he is her handler. He's 10 years older than her, and I'll go more into him, but he connected her with an underground underworld in Santa Fe that are trans drug trafficking across the country. These are still her, she thinks, best friends, that they also did with David Ferreira and the family. And I'll explain the family when I get back to my desk. And all his friends come in. This man, half and half, was in this house 4 years ago. I still try to rescue my daughter, and they come with her. And then what they do to us is unholy. But half and half sells human meat. He lived in a compound, but behind my daughter's last house. Another convicted murderer. And a lineage, his nephew was here last summer. I almost died. I don't know why I wasn't killed last summer. With his nephew's involvement, Jay Wagers. This is now 2016, the last assassination attempt. And he's from lineage with witchcraft covens going back to the 1700s in New Mexico. Somehow they were already out here through the Spanish line. So this whole group also is involved in meth manufacturing. You've heard parts of this from Kathy O'Brien, drug trafficking. Seth's best friend is convicted murderer for stabbing just as Wolf, who is my son's godfather. I have to add that this is how they get in. Wolf starts appearing in Santa Fe with Raytheon agents. And I'll go into the more detail later. So this is where they thought I would die. And the boys, they basically killed Royce off in this period here, which is 2001 to 2007. I will tell you how I escaped, and which wasn't meant to happen, and make it back to now Mountain House 2 in 2007.
Just one piece of clarification here. Although it looks like they drop off from one stage to another, that's not actually what happens.
It's not.
They trail her, and they stay connected all the way through the story.
This is true. In addition
to adding some more.
Yeah. So we now have a permanent NSA agent, and I can read his LinkedIn to you, that lives two houses down. His name is Alan Grazer, and he has been Royce's handler. He moves in his house, coincidentally, a month before we move into this house. How ironic is that? I have a lot to say about him. He's just down the road, and he monitors me 24/7, so I always say hi. Hi, Alan. It's not just out on the road. You wouldn't believe we're so rural. But I am forever diving behind trees, walking those two dogs. I live diving behind trees or flipping onto my property. I'll only at this point can walk across the front part of my property, which is 3 acres, so I can hop on it so they can't get me. Okay. I could go more into detail with this, but safe to say, this is still an army underneath Kevin Annette and Jim Craven. That a lot of this is still online, the attack to me. Okay, so I've got a partial list going of the deceased along the way. Family and people that loved me and were helping me. M is for murder, S is for suicide. And I really need to talk about this most recent suicide of the only friend I thought I had, Vic Hansen. So I'll get back to that. In the interim of Mountain House 2, where I am now, I'm taken off to London under false pretenses, forced to serve summons to Pope Ratzinger, to Sky TV, while staying at a house of a woman I've never met called Belinda McKenzie. That's 2010 London. And a whole bunch of, I'm bumping in with the Holly Grieg, David Icke, Hempstead case. And there's that still follows me around. It also followed me to Ireland, where we escaped London for 3 months. We stayed in Ireland and were under a constant attack. This is Canada. It deserves its own circle, which begins in 1998, where I meet Kevin Annette. It's not till the last 2 years I connect him to Willie Pinkton, the most famous serial killer in Canadian history, busted in 2010. It connects me with Ed John, who's runs the pedophile rings from the boarding schools of the Native First Nations children. It connects me to Harriet Nanahay, who has her own wiki page, politically assassinated for holding the tribunal. And she became one of my best friends, along with Rudy James, Rudy and Diana. Diana lived with me and protected me far beyond the tribunal. She was murdered the same day as Harriet Nanahay. So my best friend and the woman that put on the tribunal with Rudy was murdered on the same day. And that it was in 2007. So with that, I have a lot more deaths and suicides and murders. I'm trying to come out of grief and trauma to put them all down. And that was a spontaneous, I don't know, 2 months ago, I found a piece of paper in the garage and said, I'm ready. I'm ready to map this out. I'm ready to face this full on. Sorry, I'm a little triggered.
No, okay. Did those tribunals actually happen?
Oh yeah, but I mean the idea is that now the argument is it didn't. Okay,
I didn't know. I didn't know.
so let me describe the tribunal. I meet Rudy and Diana in Pine Ridge with people that were trying to help me with Naropa. I won't go into Naropa. I'm being expelled. I'm trying to help Pine Ridge because there's a fraudulent department. The entire school is involved based on their spirituality, which is all fraudulent, not a penny going to them in Pine Ridge. The people of Pine Ridge are in the most acute poverty other than Haiti in the Western Hemisphere. That includes all South American countries. Most acute statistics. So I'm trying to get that mo some money back for these. My husband's my extended family by blood and now my family and but the people of Pine Ridge. I'm trying to initiate a lawsuit and get Naropa to give them I don't know how much whatever they made, 40 million in 7 years with a fraudulent, phony Mexican Eagle Cruz FBI posing as full-blood Lakota. Well, originally the first 3 years in the course catalogs, he was a full-blood Yaqui. So, you know, that's interesting, Paul, because, you know, it's like saying that you're, well, Dalai Lama's full-blood Tibetan, but at the same time, he's Aryan. Or he's German. He's full-blood German. So, you know, you're either Yaqui. It's like saying you're a bear and a wolf at the same time.
Yeah.
So you can't be full-blood Yaqui and full-blood Lakota at the same time. You could be of mixed background, but he never said he was of mixed background, nor did the course catalogs that are charging unbelievable amounts of money since he came about 5-6 years before I moved to Boulder. The campus was going, the entire school was bankrupt. And this not only got them right, they're in a global campus expansion program now. That money he made them pretending he was full blood Lakota from Pine Ridge Indian Reservation. So I did in fact go into that. I'm being thrown out because the elders begged me to do something. I didn't initiate it, but when it initiated itself, I just simply raised my hand and said, the elders have asked me to speak. That's as far as I got. It was a war on the campus for the next 3 months, but I was never allowed to say another word. I literally raised my hand and said, the elders have asked me to speak. Out. Restraining order for Royce, the only real Indian in sight, and my boys, who are babies, the most angelic babies, who went to school with me to all those years. And that had just begun. That was March 1998. I go to Pine Ridge because there's a woman up there who was married to the medicine man that Naropa stole all the knowledge from and made the course curriculum. She called me and said, get up here, get up here again. So on a Sunday, I put the boys in the back of a car. I flew up there driving, and I meet Diana and Rudy. Probably the best thing that ever happened, or maybe not. An amazing couple. Rudy is an elder. He's a Alaskan. So he's from the Kuyukwan Nation. Again, there's bands. He's from the Tlingit Nation, and it's the Kuyukwan band. He's tribal judge, tribal elder, and he is an expert and looked at as such internationally on international law, human rights, and he heads up an NGO based out of Seattle, Washington, called IRAM, the International Rights for Human Minorities, IHR, American Association, the International Human Rights Association for American Minorities. As such, he is the liaison to report human rights abuses anywhere in the Western Hemisphere to any Indigenous people at the Subcommittee for Human Rights, Geneva, Switzerland, the United Nations. He's the liaison. We meet them. Long story short, we meet them in March. They in not too long a time had asked Royce and I to be jurors at a tribunal. And the tribunal was about the victims of that are six generations of children in the residential school program run by the Jesuits in Canada that I knew nothing about. We agreed. The tribunal was held at the, it's a giant hall. I want to say Albert Hall, but that's London. The Maritime Hall in Vancouver, Canada. There were thousands of people in that hall. It's a very big hall. And it seats, I would say 2,000 people. Press was there from everywhere. Radios were there. There were 30 jurors. Royce and I were two of those jurors. On it, there were three tiers. We were on the first tier at a long table. Above us is Rudy and Diana at their own table. And above them is a man called Dr. Cly. And there's very little about him on the net, but I'm not sure of the title, but he directly worked for the United Nations as a Canadian resident. He was the Canadian embassy or diplomatic. So Rudy had to report and function under Dr. Cly. He was a very elegant black man, educated, graceful. So then the rest of the hall facing us were the victims and the perpetrators. And there were thousands outside who'd come from all over Canada that were victims, you know, police blocking, traffic jams. The tribunal lasts 5 days. It begins in June 1998. The first day is review for the jurors, all kinds of meetings all day long, before the beginning of the actual tribunal. The tribunal lasts 3 days, which is more than 30 witnesses coming forward to give their testimony. The fifth day is wrap up and completion for the jurors with Dr. Cly and Rudy and Diana. And then everyone gets to get in the car and go home. And the jurors were international. There were Asians, there were South Americans. These were credible, educated people in the respective academic fields. My credibility was journalism, photojournalism. Royce's was his leadership. He was chosen by his elders to be, you know, from the early 80s, you know, by all of them. They had one young man that was going to save them, and that was Royce White Calf. He was incredible. So more than any other, and he was beloved by those elders and medicine men, the likes of which are Pete Catches, Frank Bullscrow, the ones still living, Wilmer Mesteth, the elders, Chief Oliver Red Cloud, Johnson Holyrock, the front page New York Times when he died 6 years ago. The most revered elder of the history of the 1900s, Johnson, Uncle Johnson, etc. There were about seven elders that demanded Royce this, that. There was no other like Royce. So we go to the tribunal, and the tribunal, a man comes up to me with this stupid little Scottish hat on, running with his little wire rim glasses with curly hair, and he, you know, looks all, you gain his sympathy immediately. He comes dashing for me on the first day in between meetings, you know, filled with files under his arm. I'm here to help the indigenous people. Oh my, hi, Kevin Annette, nice to meet you. That's the night I met him. And it was on the phone. By the time I got back to where I was staying, he's telling me about the murders, the this victim just got murdered, this, you know, murders everywhere. He's the only one recording them. To the forum of Indians that had gathered, First Nations peoples, to put on this tribunal, headed by Harriet Nanahe.
Okay, who was the guy with the hat?
Kevin Annette.
Oh, that was Kevin.
That's
okay.
Kevin.
Enter Kevin. Major player in the rest of the story.
Scottish hat. Looks adorable. He's not part of the tribunal, but he lied a lot. He was there supposedly for a group of First Nations people that had organized to have the tribunal called the Circle of Justice. Their denouncing of him has disappeared offline, of course. But I have a document That was hard to get. I almost got killed over getting it 3 months ago. So,
I can prove Kevin. Kevin went offline, but he's still around.
I really don't pay too much attention these last few years. What's his status? He's still around?
I don't know.
Okay. So also at the tribunal is a juror sitting next to me. A white man, my, he's blonde and he grew his hair a little bit long and he's got Indian jewelry on. And this guy's his name is Jim Craven, and he's Blackfoot Elder, even though he was 40. Now there's elders. These, you know, they don't talk. They're too humble. And this was a white man. This is no Indian elder. Roy spotted it instantly. Not only that, he calls himself.
You have to be an Indian to be an Indian elder. That's pretty obvious.
Dude, one would assume.
Except for this guy.
I mean, maybe you could apply, Paul. Maybe I could apply. And Mindy, I mean, you know, who knows? Maybe my dogs and my cats, they would pass for elders at this point. That's what the FBI has done to these great nations. So Jim Craven starts acting violently the night he enters, just after I meet Kevin, violently. Everybody, see, this was prearranged. This is what they do. Controlled opposition. They're both working together. They pose as enemies. One's going to be it's the good cop, bad cop. Let me plug this back in. So Kevin Annette's going to be the good cop who's under attack from the obvious Fed. Everybody, you know, sees this is the obvious Fed infiltrator, Jim Craven, because he's creating all the violence, throwing me up against walls. He's hyperbolic the whole time, out of control, screaming, incredible behavior. He's the FBI agent. Kevin looks so sweet, and he's such a hero, and he's going to help Lydia and Royce and all those victims who, after we left, all were murdered in the a vast majority of them just happened to be standing next to them when they were beaten to death and murdered in other ways. They always just happen to be standing next to Kevin Annette, right next to him. One minute they're alive, the next minute they're dead. The witnesses we heard that whose voice went to the United Nations in Geneva just happened to be standing next to Kevin for the next 10 years when they all died. And this is part of his movie called Repentant No Longer, or whatever. It's Unrepentant Canada's. They're all in it before he had the murder, before he murdered them. So we come home thinking, oh my God, FBI agent. For me, it was, you know, the big first, Jim Craven. You know, Kevin's calling, hi, Kev. Started the first night of the tribunal. This is a week later. I'm back in Boulder. I arrive back. You know, Kevin's already calling, oh, Kevin, what do we do? I'm so scared about Jim Craven. This goes on for 12 more years. So, but they're, okay. We also arrive home. I'm served another court summons the day after we get back. We got back late at night. It's only a 36 hour drive to Vancouver with the babies in the back. And I'm a single driver. And I have a weekend workshop coming up at Naropa the next day. I'm served with a new lawsuit from Eagle Cruz, the FBI agent, the Lakota Yaqui, you name it, guacamole medicine man, because he's mixed up in a blender genetically. I'm served by a lawsuit with Royce for trespassing on his property, which never happened. And I have a cousin in town from on my father's side of the family who's an attorney, who is a very good friend. No longer, of course. I called him, Peter, what do I do? oh my God, I'm getting sued for $25,000. You know, Royce and I never had a spare penny. We lived well. We weren't in, you know, I got a nice little house. We managed beautifully. He worked. I got student loans, thanks to Hillary. I still haven't paid all the way back. And because I was expelled, I still owe those student loans. But I'm down to 18,000 on those. So anyway, Peter said, Lydia, it sounds like you need someone. He specialized in like real estate, even though he went to the court. He said, you need somebody different and somebody with some knowledge about Indian law, I think. Not that that was true. No, I just was being sued by a Mexican, a citizen of Boulder. But that's what Peter said. And he said, I'll start looking around tomorrow in the courthouse. So thank you, Peter. Now I'm back 2 nights from the tribunal. Peter calls the next morning. Oh my, this guy just crossed my path. You know, I've never seen him before, but he says he's been working as an attorney in Boulder for quite a few years. Anyway, he hands me his card, Lydia. This is Peter calling me from the courthouse. Here's his number. His name is W. Lee Hill. And, you know, he looks Indian. He's got a ponytail. This is Peter telling me. He's in jeans with cowboy boots and a belt and tie. Really good looking guy, really young and smart. Call him right away. He'll help you. He told me, Peter said, I hear your cousin needs an attorney. Passed him in the courthouse. I didn't see that yet. This is how they all come into our lives. Peter didn't find that suspicious. He said, oh my, what a coincidence. He just ran into me in the courthouse. Guy I've never seen, hands me the card, says, I hear your cousin needs an attorney. So let me read a little piece about Walter Lee Hill. That's the center figure of it all. Way above in importance, Kevin, Wolf, Jim Craven. We got a lot of animals, you know, Wolf, Craven. Okay. I found this online 3 years ago. It's not easy to find. It's a document by a guy called Chris Zack on Angel Fire. I can put a link to it. So I'm going to read parts of it to this audience. Zoominfo.com profiles at Chris Zack, Boulder, Colorado. Email address, employment, profiler. This is the writer of this document, and he's going to tell us who Lee Hill is. So just hold on. Present NSA, National Security Agency, Denver, Colorado, United States. Board membership and affiliations. Honorary to 2005, present FOP, Fraternal Order of Police, Denver, Colorado, United States. Education, BS Criminal Justice, 1993-1997, University of Colorado, Boulder. Certifications, Jiu-Jitsu, Black Belt, Third Degree, 1998, Ken Kojuku. I find out that they all do that. All of my agents are Black Belts in the same school, Jiu-Jitsu. Biography, 2006, Chris Zack, known as Zen Master Zack, has resided in Boulder, Colorado for the last 25 years. Chris's livelihood has been bounty hunting, special case agents for federal departments as a contractor. The past 5 years, his concentration has been on all the people who have tried to associate themselves with the John Binet Murder Ramsey case of 1996. Hold on. His concern is not to solve that case. No, no, we don't want to solve Dyncore child pedophilia rat line.
You don't want to solve it.
Anything but. But to follow the trail left behind by those who interfered with the investigation and seek out their true motives and current livelihoods. Enter Lee Hill. Key figures in his hunt have turned us, sorry, where's, okay. Some of the hottest targets Chris has followed up on are as follows. Walter Lee Hill, my Indian attorney. Known by several names. I'm reading this 3 years ago. We've been warned that this guy was a federal agent or I didn't know till 3 years ago. Walter Lee Hill, known by several names. It's not that we didn't know at the end, 3 years into Lee Hill, that Lee Hill was a federal agent, obviously. But we didn't understand that's not what Lee Hill is. That's not what Lee Hill is. Formerly assistant DA in San Diego. We all know what that means. Narco-terrorism. The guy's about 37, handsome as hell, brilliant, brilliant, and highly trained, because he had us hypnotized. I'll say more about that later. He posed as an attorney. This is the NSA writing this. He posed, I'll provide a link, as an attorney in Boulder, posed as an attorney, doesn't say to who, and infiltrated the JonBenet Ramsey case for ulterior motives. He was on the defense team for Leonard Peltier. That was the first thing he said to Royce, to get Royce to trust him. And he was dark-skinned and brown-eyed with this fake ponytail, enough for us to believe that he was part Choctaw. I'm working on the, you know, I'm Leonard's new attorney, Royce, nice to meet, you know, Royce fell for it. You can't fool Royce, but this, he fooled Royce. He's the only one that fooled Royce. This guy was the guy. Okay.
Yeah, and he's recommended by your attorney, who just happened to bump into him.
My cousin.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, he'd never met him. I just called Peter the night before and said, I'm being sued, I need help. Peter said, I'll look around, it'll take me a few days, and calls me first thing in the morning with the number of Lee Hill, who crossed his path that first thing that morning. He already knew who Peter was, of course, and where to look for him.
No, that's why that telephone surveillance comes in real handy when you're
exactly
an NSA operative.
Exactly, and this is still only 1998 now. Okay, now this is Zen Master, the NSA agent, continuing about Lee Hill. He works with the radical terrorist organization in the American Indian Movement, meaning, I've reread that many times. He works with the radical terrorist organization in the Indian American Indian Movement. I read that as an individual by the name of Royce White Calf, who is the radical terrorist organization within the American Indian Movement. They don't name Royce or me in this document. Royce has got quite the terrorist.
You guys are really pretty scary.
Oh my God. And not only that, he's so much fun, you know. I mean, we would laugh and laugh no matter what was happening. So he's working with the radical terrorist organization inside. That's the way it's phrased. So I'm left to assume that's Royce. And has been quietly the head of a special ops group supported by the CIA. He is suspected to be CIA himself all this time. Walter Lee Hill is now a seriously hunted man who may have gone underground or is already dead. State and federal warrants are out on this man. He vanished in 2003. This trail leads to many people in Boulder. Attorney Dennis Blewett, a high-ranking officer in the Freemasons who seemed to sabotage his colleague that Lee Hill was investigating. It goes on, more CIA stuff, Lee Hill, surveillance. I'll stop with the reading there. I think you get the idea. I do have pictures of Lee and Russell in court in Boulder County on my behalf. Lee became our attorney. Russell told us from the get-go he already knew Lee and that Lee was a fit. But we had the two of them live with us for 3 years in the first house.
And also, back then, Fed didn't mean deep state.
Exactly. Exactly, Paul. You so get this. See, that's where everything changed 4 years ago. I'm sitting here one day going, okay, they say FBI, FBI, the Pine Ridge people, FBI, FBI, but it's counterinsurgency, police, law enforcement. And really, I saw a film in 2007 called Breach, which is the story of Robert Hansen, the greatest mole of U.S. intelligence history, that's serving 347 life sentences or whatever in Colorado here, the Supermax prison. I saw Breach, and Robert Hansen is a high-ranking FBI who is where the CIA investigates and does bust him. This is the true historic story of our last greatest mole, who wasn't executed, sold all our secrets to Russia, busted in 2005 or 2006. The film comes out in 2007. That's where it really began. I'm watching this movie with my boys and I'm saying, FBI, CIA, FBI, CIA. There's no difference. That's what I said, that there's no difference. The FBI is the CIA. The CIA is the FBI. So when everybody in Pine Ridge 4 years later is saying FBI, they could be saying CIA. That's when I open this book and I go, oh my God, it's not CIA. It's our special operations forces that just killed Saddam Hussein and Gaddafi and on the world stage, Vietnam, you name the war. Okay, so I went into that kind of shock. Because this is Lee Hill and the other documents I showed. So I'm suddenly, this is 4 years ago when I began to realize, oh my God, because Royce and I had sat here through the whole thing going, what did we do? 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 Even to the last month he was here, we're still, and I mean 20 years into it. What did we do? What did we do? What did we do? What did we do, babe? I don't know. What did we do? So I know that was a sort of long-winded, but I'll now briefly cover the three phases. The military nightmare from hell. We sell our house downtown 8 months after we get back from the tribunal. Now Lee Hill's a permanent fixture every day from that first phone call in that house downtown. And we need to move up here for many reasons, but we'd had three horses and they were being kept up here. And I don't know, it was, I often wonder what made us decide to move up here, because none of this could have happened downtown. But as we moved up here in April 1998, we had some friends come along. The US military, everything but the tanks. So it starts right away. You know, the first morning, me and the boy, there's a mattress that I just bought. They just delivered. The house is empty. We just, you know, signed the papers. We hadn't officially moved, but we want to get up to those mountains. So me and the Sophia and the boys are, you know, in a mountain house. It's so beautiful up here. And the very first morning, we're woken up by just thunder over our heads. Thunder, helicopters, Apaches, nonstop. Wow, that was strange, because we're in this mountain setting. You'd think it's Alaska. It's anywhere, any direction you look, it's endless wilderness. Well, that was strange, Sophia. She's like, Mom, you know, it's a Pine Ridge thing. I'm like, no way. That's how it starts. That's day one. Life in the mountain house that lasts 3 years. The next thing we notice within a few days are the non-stop roving. There's a road system, it's rural, that actually can go in a circle around that property. We called it the block. Non-stop, predominantly white, SUVs, blackout windows, black antenna, the Mr., what was his name in Matrix, Mr. Smith, or, you know, the agent that always chased Neo. So the sunglasses are always Ray-Bans, the wires behind both ears, they never move, suit and tie. Sometimes there were black SUVs, predominantly white. I called it the snake. It never stopped. It was ongoing 24/7, maybe an hour. You wouldn't see one all day, all night. Royce, what the? Then boots on the roof. Boots on the roof. Then, oh my God, the brake lines are hanging under the car. The shed just got pulled down, torn apart. Now it's every morning, 50 feet over our head. It was always right over the beam to just a few years ago. 9, 10, 12 helicopters always added a small plane to this day. So the small plane comes either first or last. It depends which circle, whether it's Santa Fe, Mountain House 1, Mountain House 2. The helicopters with the plane never stop. And then you can see them at night. Those three guys in camouflage, right? Because we're now in the rural. Royce, and we're under attack by every angle by friends of Royce's moving in with us, arriving from the long-term prison sentence. Knock, knock, knock. Bro, I got out 10 years early. Let me help you this. Let me. Of those, that the prison recruitment system, you don't want to know what they did to us. Always trying to separate the marriage. Women at Royce, these thugs at me, not that that worked, but they stole my credit cards, cars, kidnapped my daughter. So this is the beginning of military. And now Lee Hill is and Kevin and Ed are starting to do some strange things together with Ward Churchill, and every possible kind of entrapment, every possible kind. So I'll finish up this phase and move to phase two, because, you know, this is long-winded and I'm summarizing 20 years. So, but Lee had specialized in transpersonal psychology and paranormal psychology he was the student of, don't fall over, Timothy Leary and Allen Ginsberg on the island most covered with a dentist chair in the basement, Cooper Island.
Both of those people, in case you don't know.
I know.
Trace their leads right back to Tavistock.
I know.
The whole orchestration movement and all.
I know all about, they also founded Naropa.
I know you knew, I know they founded Naropa. I thought it was related to Esalen and that whole lineage.
They founded the Beats, came here with William Burroughs. These are all Lee Hill's best friends. William Burroughs, Allen Ginsberg, Timothy Leary. And there's another document I'll send you a link to where Lee writes his own obituary, which is 30 pages long. And I just found him last month alive in Hong Kong, alive and well. I was told he was dead in 2003.
Who did you find?
Lee Hill, he's alive. I just found him last month online. I had to shift the words around. He's under Leon Hill. It's Lee. I'll send the links, you can see, and I'll scan the photos of Lee in court for me. It's Lee. So Lee is alive.
Thank God that scumbag's alive. Huh? Jeez. Couldn't happen to a nice.
I have a fantasy of, because I used to live in Maui before I moved to Singapore. And so he lives in Hilo, and I had family friends that I grew up with that lived in Hilo. So I've been to Hilo. And I just thought I might, you know, if some money falls out of the sky, hop a flight to Maui and show up at the front door. I really want to, Paul. Knock, knock. Let's do some spook craft talk. Let's,
oh, yeah.
Let's go out and dance and do the spooky boo-boo. Come on, Lee. Talk about the, you know, the agency and Leary and MK Ultra. Did you know you and Cameron too, or Delgado, or were you here because Royce had a RFID in his brain since he was 5? Is that why you were you Royce's handler?
Yeah.
What was it? Politics? What was it? What did I do?
Right. What happened? When does Steven Seagal, who's the actor, right?
Right. Oh, well, this is Lee's never-ending list of, oh, I'll put you in touch with, I'll, let's go. Lee always had. So it was, you know, it got the thrill going and the hypnosis. He was a professionally trained NLP hypnotist. He had Royce so hypnotized. That's where I say it's MKUltra with Royce. So two things happen, and then I'll wrap up phase one. Lee.
Just for, if you missed stage one, Royce was MKUltra from the beginning. He was subject to, as a child, through these Indian schools, mind control. So he's not fresh from the beginning.
What Royce was able to tell me the last time he was here, and he's brought this up before, but we really started to focus on this. In the early 60s, in that poverty, there's no phones, there's dirt roads. He's way out in the middle of nowhere in one of the shacks, because there were quite a few, where he and his 9 siblings, I would say, survived. One episode of he starts wanting me to know in this last phase of our marriage within the last 2 years. I think he's told me about it at the beginning, and we just didn't think to rethink it. He has a memory of 1 minute being in in the shack with his parents and siblings, way out. The Indians have a sense of humor, but anything west of Pine Ridge, they call out west. And I'm from New York, so out west. We're out. So out west was the shack. Royce, one of them. Anyway, he was there, and the next thing he knows, he wakes up in the hospital, the old hospital that still stands in Pine Ridge. And there's these black curtains that are closed. And there's a priest standing there reading out of a Bible his last rite, like Kathy O'Brien, last rites. Royce wakes up, doesn't know how long he's been there, and says, he's a little boy, he's 5. And the priest sees him wake up and says, you're going to die now. You have, I think they told him tuberculosis or smallpox. You're going to die. We're taking care of it. Royce is already so terrorized by 5. This is how he recounts it to me. I said, what happened next? The nurses come in, throw open the black windows, and say, you can go home now. And they released him.
So help me understand what happened.
Help me understand what happened. He was kidnapped, which up there at that time in the 60s, I don't know if they don't need a word kidnapping. They don't have law. So the Jesuit priests, somebody comes to get him when he's a little boy, and I don't know how long they had him and where he physically went, but when he wakes up with memory, he's in that hospital room with a priest in long black robes, a Jesuit priest, telling him he's going to die. And he's reading him his last rites, where my hair stood up when I read Kathy O'Brien's story about the last rites and the Catholic rite, R-I-T-E. They throw up in the way and he can go home now. Then he will say, and he said this from the get-go, and we really honed in on this last time he was here. That's where he started hearing voices. Because when I met him, he was already diagnosed for a long time with what they called trauma psychosis. He heard voices. And so I didn't, Naropa doesn't really go into things like this. And, you know, and they're Royce has psychosis from trauma. It was pretty traumatic. I went forever without putting together the dots, Paul. Psychosis from the voices, since the day I meet him, they have periods of tormenting him. Starting phase one, Mountain House one, they went on full time and never went off. And what they did to him in that first Mountain House, it is drive him. I mean, the man was so strong. It took so much work on their part to destroy the fabric of this man. I can't put it into words. The money it must have cost them. You know, a knock is the most expensive agent for the CIA. It's their, you know, non-officially. We know we had four on us. It took really 15 years and four knocks and that army I just showed you to take Royce out. Again, 1,000 cavalry to one Indian, but in the end, they did. And that, watching that, having to witness it, because it really was a 12, 15 year period of the man I married, now what, 7 years, suddenly becoming, it wasn't the man, it was, and that was started in 1999, and until the last time I saw him in 4 years ago. So I can just, you know, okay, I can return to phase three, and I'll summarize from here because this has been long-winded. Lee was always the guy with the answers. That's another thing you learn along the way. The ones with the answers and the help are the very ones, right, that are the problem. They create the problem, then provide you with the help and the answer. So Lee has, oh God, I'm best friends with Steven Seagal, and he's coming to Naropa, and you know, because he's now a teacher, but he wants a private meeting with you guys. So we had a private meeting with Seagal, you know, Tuku, and he says, "I've got my
teacher at Naropa."
Yes, of course, CIA. You know, he's been named a head Tuku or whatever. The year before, this was 1998, by Dalai Lama. So he's one of the high priests now. Not quite Karmapa level, but a tulku. I don't give any attention to Buddhism or Tibetan Buddhism. So
well, I won't go into the Dalai Lama, although I really could. We'll just go with that.
Yeah. There we have esoteric Hitlerism and, you know, Eva Savala, and you know, which leads us to the current Alexander Dugin and that Satanism.
Anyway. Well, he's on the payroll. His brother's full-time CIA, and he's on the payroll.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah,
I know,
you know, but just for the audience.
Oh no, I didn't. Yeah, I agree. I mean, I'm more in agreement. I'm aware. I've studied that part of. You know, from the counterculture and the players and the geopolitical aspects. So, yeah, I've really looked into esoteric Hitlerism and esoteric Marxism and the occult history, I think more thoroughly than most people do, just because that's my interest. So into the modern times with Dalai Lama and anyway, because I'm trying to figure out what makes these people tick.
Right. And what's real?
What?
We're trying to find out what's real.
Yeah. I mean, what is happening? Why? So that's been my question since my earliest memories. What? You know, so that's why I've studied the occult history so deeply, because that's what I set out to do when I made a first connection when I was 18, then I've been on fire ever since. And that we could do it, that's the first time I talked to you, that's where that goes. And so,
Lee, I really don't want to do a whole podcast on that. Maybe with the help of Catherine Horton.
Yeah.
I want you to finish your story.
No, I'll do anything you want. I'm excited and I'm ready and, you know, absolutely. And I'm grateful. So, all right. So there are two things that really, revisiting them in the last years put a high alert. Lee always buddied up to Royce in the, hey, I was the cop, LAPD, and go jogging with me, Royce. And then he'd get Royce alone, he'd pull up his sweatpants and there'd be a Glock on an ankle holster. And he knew how to work Royce. Nobody else on planet Earth could work Royce. I honestly take my hat off to Lee Hill, because Royce is not manipulable. He's too... But no, this guy had Royce going around like a dog on a, you know, Royce, let's go get you some guns. We're in the mountain house now. This stuff's happening. Lee's pretending, you know, of course, gee, let me try to help figure out what's going on with you guys. Maybe there's somebody I know at LAPD. I'll call here. I'll call out. Lee played us. And, you know, oh, thanks, man, what Royce would say. But he says, you know, you guys should get some arms. So Lee takes us out to Longmont. Now, this is the only language Royce knows because he's been in a war for, you know, his whole life. Military up till he was 26. 1986, this ended. So he's playing on that with Royce. Let's get you some AKs. So off to Longmont, and we get loaded up with ammo. I'm swiping my mother's credit card. I call it the Bank of England. Unfortunately, it stopped swiping about 10 years ago. That was Seth Leach, the bankrupter, the guy and my daughter's handler. If I could get away with it, I called it the low-hanging fruit. You know, I could grab one every decade and have something to eat. So off we go, and Royce gets both the Chinese and the Kalashnikov. And the vest, and a vest for Lydia, and a baby Glock for Lydia, and ammo, and all kinds of other... And puts us back in our house. Now, doesn't that sound like a Ruby Ridge situation? Because there's so many cases where they killed and took out Black Panthers, and white people, as in Ruby Ridge, under the guise of self-defense, firing into the house. With a guy, it actually has arms in the house now.
Yeah, absolutely.
Luckily, that never happened. Luckily that, but I mean, that's what that was about. Royce patrolled the halls for a year, all night long, the last year, with two AKs and a couple of whatevers. In the meantime, Lee had all these friends, but the meeting was Steven Seagal. Steven Seagal says to us, you know, he was really honored to meet Royce because he does all those Indian movies. And, you know, I'm just like, hi, man. Anyway, Steven says, I'll give you my best bodyguards. They're arriving tomorrow. You know, they'll be in Denver. They'll be up. Just so these two Delta Force guys arrive. This is about 2000. And this is the summer. At this point, I'm in what I call nervous breakdown phase one, where I'm literally unable to walk or talk for about the following 2 years. We had a room out in the garage that I made into a living space, and I'd go out there so I wouldn't freak the boys out, and dial madly everyone I knew from the portaphone. All my old friends that never spoke to me again, my family, oh, this is FBI, CIA. I'm crazy. No one's ever talked to me since then. But I was in that kind of panic. enter the bodyguards. They said, we'll assess what's going on. You guys go to bed. They got all chummy with Royce. They were nice guys. Sean and I remember the other guy's name. Anyway, they're you know, looking like our guys today in Iraq and Syria, the whole works, draped in weaponry and the funny helmets. So up comes the morning, and I'm breastfeeding through all of this. And, you know, I wear a simple nightgown. It's mountains. I'm barefoot. And the more serious one, I'll remember his name in a minute, calls me down the deck stairs out onto the, you know, meadow in the front of the house and looks really concerned and says, I mean, I've never seen a military special ops guy in the first place, but let alone one looking this upset. And he says, Mrs. Whitecalf. And I mean, the guy was sweating. He was on the edge of crying. And this was the quiet, serious one. And then he was going like this. What in God's name are you two into? What have you done? And I'm already in that panic attack, you know, and a thing that I stayed in for the first 2 years. And I've got my little Kogi, but my baby, the youngest son, in my arms, and I looked at him and I went, breastfeeding? That was my answer.
Right. I couldn't,
that was my answer to him. And he said, you have the highest level surveillance and intimidation program on planet Earth at this time. And even David Rockefeller could not have it taken down, which meant nothing to me back then. This was only 1998, 99, 2000. There was no Google yet, I wasn't using Google. It was just being born. I didn't know enough. Even David Rockefeller himself couldn't. This is above him. That's what he told me. So he said, you have an electromagnetic field over your house, and I'd recommend you get a meter and measure it. I'm like, and I didn't talk for 2 or 3 weeks. I was still standing there 3 weeks later in my bare feet with the baby.
My breast.
You have dedicated satellites. They can see you through. They know what bed you're sleeping in, that, you know, and they're beaming you. And that you could get cancer and die. You need to know from 1 to 10. Exactly what the measurement of the hertzes are, because a 10 is cancer and fatal. There are 7 listening posts in a 7-mile radius around your house. And it was, I hate to tell you, Paul, and I mean, I'll be honest, it was 6 months ago, when I was writing the SGT report article, I was brushing my teeth. And I'm thinking about those listening posts, because all I ever envisioned was wood posts. And I kept thinking all these years, why didn't I ask them where they are so I could go look at these wood posts? What is, you know, and 6 months ago, I'm brushing my teeth and I go, my son had just asked me to rewatch the movie Traffic, where there's a van with the FBI's listening. It took that many years. There were these white RVs. We know about 5 of them. We had to pass them all the time in a, you know, on the way to Ned and on the way to Boulder up here surrounding. They had 500 antennas of all different. They're always blackout windows, Colorado plates. Royce and I would pass them. What is up with those camping couple parking in the middle of the road for 2 years now? Those are the listening posts.
You didn't know that was your tax dollars at work.
I didn't figure it out till 6 months ago. I hate to say it. It was writing that article. And my sons can tell you this, because I went screaming for my older son right away. I said, Dante, what is a listening post? And he didn't have an answer either. And I said, is it a wood? It's a wood post, right? And he said, I guess. And I said, we just watched Traffic last night. That's the guys in the van. That's a listening. And I could see the look in his eyes because he's heard about the big RVs. So we were surrounded by in a seven. And that's part of, I think, what put the EMF over our heads. I don't know. But I was told, watch out. They know what bed you're sleeping in. They listen, even if you're whispering, they hear every word. Everything's bugged. I mean, this is beyond bugged. It's the highest level security and surveillance. So that's when I start having symptoms of falling over, crushing, exhaustion, weakness. And don't forget, I'd athlete. And then I had 15 years of yoga, and I was thin, fit, muscular. And it begins in that house, my terminal illness under that field. And long story short, Leo had another idea at this point. Oh, Lydia, I can take you to the head of the FBI downtown. She won't question that. And you can ask him what's going on and what you should do, which then happens. I had to go through four steel doors off Walnut Street. This is now middle of the summer, 2002. I haven't told you about the kidnapping story yet, but this is where occultism comes in. That's the year before. At the FBI, the head of the FBI in Boulder, Jeffrey Snow, plays dumb but says I should probably flee the state. He planted the idea and he said, you know what would be smart? Stay offline forevermore. I obeyed because I'm such a good girl. I'm a good daughter. I'm a good citizen. I didn't go online for 5 years. Oh, the FBI told me, you know. Because if I started going online now that there's Google, how to keep me isolated and how to keep me dumb. I can't start researching what's happening.
It's real important that people listening to this know that the FBI, the CIA, just like Catherine Horton's website, stop007.org. These are not your friends. These are the guys that are doing all the deep state child trafficking, organ harvesting, surveillance, like Lydia's talking about. They do arms trafficking. They do false flags that start wars. These are not good guys. And Lydia and I, 5 years ago, 4 years ago, even a couple of years ago, you think, well, they're probably doing something good. Get that out of your brain. They're not doing anything good.
And the reason
they're the corrupting force that's causing the problems.
That's right.
So wake up to that. Okay, go on, Lydia. I'm sorry.
For all the secrecy is because they're the ones committing all the crimes. They're committing untold murder of Americans. Well, let's just talk about America. And how many I buried in Pine Ridge, just, you know, brutal murders. Brutal murders of our friends. Brutal members to black people. Since the American Revolution, it's kind of been, at what phase do we start with who they are?
You can start with the Jesuits. You could start with the original 007, John Dee, who sold his soul to the devil for gold. I mean, it's been that way. It's secrecy that's the enemy.
Exactly.
In these organizations. When they run in secret, they're keeping something from you. When you open something up, like an open source investigation, good things happen. We learn stuff. But secrecy is always not in your best interest.
Exactly.
I can't think of an exception.
Yeah.
Go finish your story, Lydia. I'm sorry.
I think this is very important. Because they are criminals, because Satanism is, and this is why I've studied where I can really find the beginnings 2,500 years ago of who they are. I mean, a really thorough study, not the online Khazar Jew conspiracy, not much deeper and authentic study. They are the criminal. I always saw that this was a criminal civilization. That's, you know, Royce and I didn't have to, you know, break the ice. He didn't have to, you know, that's, he'd never met a white person that already got that. That was the bond. You know, there was nothing he had to, you know, bring me out of any box to. You know, we were instant best friends, making fun of it all and horrified by it all, crying, laughing both from the minute we met. So so they commit all the crimes. What's the problem is if we might find out some truth about them by accident, even, then we end up with this. That's what happened to me, because I heard about the pedophilia as a juror and even got a death threat not to send my findings to the UN, sent them anyway. I'm the only one that did. I wrote about that in the article. We could link that to this vid. I sent my findings to the UN. I'm the only one. Diana was dead 7 years later. She took them with Rudy to the UN. I was supposed to go. That was the second kidnapping. I was put... And this is where I might lose people. So I'm you know, hesitant to go too much into the how many times I've been kidnapped. But Royce has been kidnapped 7 times, where he would always get me out, I'd always get him out. He was put in the state ward, it's kidnapping level, in 2005. And he actually got himself busted out of the state ward in South Dakota within the weekend and got free. He was brilliant with these guys. He got free police escort back, 16-hour drive from Sioux Falls to drop him off in Rapid City, free of charge, all gas paid for, food along the way, from a state officer. You know, when he busted himself out of the state ward. So they escorted him home even. And he was the reason I kept getting out, because he had this, no white guy would mess with Royce. I don't care, a police officer. Lee Hill was the only one that could mess with Royce and got away with it. No one even ever tried. No police officer. They've shackled him in front of me and the boys. They've beaten him. They've re-split open his head from when he was 13, and they tortured him in Pine Ridge in front of us. But he'd stand up. I don't care what they'd just done. This is all along Boulder County Police, downtown, up here, Nederland, Santa Fe, the constant racial profiling, shackling him in front of every age of my boys. There they are again, woo, around Royce, shackling him, pounding his head into the top of the car, beating him, you know, billy clubbing him in front of us, just out of nowhere. And he'd start talking low, calm, and all of a sudden undo the cuffs. I'm sorry, Mr. White Calf, we apologize. 12 cars disappear. He knew his rights. He was that smart. He was a Malcolm X. Those, I don't care who they were, KKK, they ran in fear from Royce. Paul, I go back and forth. Was that the problem? Was that, or there are all the above the problems? The tribunal, I sent the findings. The ability Royce had, no white man could be, could screw with him. He could come to people like you and me, and without speaking, we could understand the real meaning of freedom. He might make a sound bite. He was waking people up like it was the opposite of the LSD freedom. That's not freedom. That's vacating the psyche. The intellect is vacating this drug freedom hoax. Royce brought it back. If he interacted with you for 30 seconds, he woke you up. Wherever he went, that he walked it. His truth. And he was so decent. So was that the problem? Was it that he's chipped and he was kidnapped at 5 and he's being a human experiment? And even that took forever to torture him to death. No matter what his visuals and audio you know, for the last 12 years, were, it was, and they were cooking him alive in front of me the last 6 months.
I think it's really impossible, Lydia, for us to try to figure out what's going on, because our minds are so wired so differently than these psychopaths. So I interrupted you. Go ahead.
Well, this is the best book I've ever read that summarizes. This is ex-CIA agent Jim Keith, who was murdered for writing this book. I've never found, and lo and behold, in the middle, what do I find under Consolidating Control, chapter 14? I just should read this. LEAA, which is the Justice Department's Law Enforcement Assistance Administration, which heads these secret operations, domestic and international. LEAA was also involved in plans for the creation of a national police force and urban warfare preparation that went by the names Operation Garden Plot and Cable Splicer. This book. Last week I'm reading this book and I open it to, this is the crimes, this is basically reporting the church committee's findings. And hold on. On page 20. Meanwhile, the CIA continued to use university professors, journalists, university professors. Jim Craven is a professor. Ward Churchill's a professor. Kevin was a professor. Labor leaders, public houses, publishing houses, cultural organizations, and philanthropic fronts to mold U.S. public opinion, quote unquote, cited. All of this, all these three books are cited, footnoted. This immaculate works. At the same time, Special Army Special Forces, this is this third book. Army Special Forces and other elite military units. This is written in 1989, this book. Began to train local police, that's where I caught on, for counterinsurgency, and to, now I know the word well, counterinsurgency, and to intensify their own preparations, quote, garden plot and cable splicer. I can't get away from the word now. I thought it just had to do with Pine Ridge. That's I only heard one man ever say it. It was Royce. He's from Pine Ridge. I never heard of it. I didn't know other people knew about it. So I can't, now I can't go to any book that we all don't have in the big study of the, you know, whether it's the financial crime world or the, you know, the categories we've all studied, and not come across Operation Garden Plot and Cable Splicer. So exactly, trying to, but I will say this is the most important book for the other women. I'm not an expert at the electromagnetic weaponry the way Rumala D is and Catherine Horton, but in all my research, I cannot, this goes from beginning to end. This is Jim Keith. He was murdered for this book. I haven't found a better compilation. You will fall over. I just read this last week, and I can't emphasize how important this is for all of us to read. This is the one they killed him over, and it is so. It's the every study of from Ewan Cameron and their papers, every part of this country and Canada. Everything they've done since the 1910s, 20s, 30s to today. And it's beyond the proof of electromagnetic weaponry. It's beyond that. It's and their ideology and the New World Order. I mean, he tells it all in a brilliant, easy to read sweep that's cited. The research papers are incredible that are cited here by all the evil sociopaths that did all the research post-Germany Operation Paperclip. In all these universities, whether it's McGill, all over the country, to all of us, to today. And why I have this chronic illness that's terminal that I've had since the Mountain House 1999, the first, and I'm bedridden, I've been bedridden for 12 years. I couldn't work if I thought about it. I've taken stabs at having a psychotherapy business. Every time I take a stab at working, I get hit in violent episodes with self-pronounced, I'm CIA, you know, boom. I've gotten violently accosted. I'm not allowed to work, apparently. So, of course not. So, however, I'm going to work now. And even though I'm basically bedridden and I've been in and out of leukemia and diabetes and whatnot, and I should get to phase two because this is already, and I'll wrap up really quickly with phase two and phase three. Phase two is meant to kill us. We're told to flee. I flee. We sell the house and in a month we're gone. Odd but true, we're on the road with the moving vans on 9/12. Odd but true. We arrive in Santa Fe and we enter into a world I don't know how to put into words. And I'm going to be brief and finish this up with phase two and phase three. It's impossible to go into detail to the episodes. It was entering a different dimension. The dimension is hell itself. Once we crossed the border into New Mexico, we were in Dante's Inferno. Nothing operated in the law of physics of the world you and I are in now. The house we bought, I just can't put into words. It was the most unbearable, and I don't know how I survived, walk of 6 years through demonic evil, living with it. It followed us everywhere we went. There were thousands that dwelled in this little old adobe house with us, thousands of demons, ghosts. It was nonstop. It was visual, audio, lights on and off, windows breaking, didn't break, play with reality, see you. My son's little boys kept seeing themselves, talking to them. The horror stories of the hauntings are the worst part. To them, to Royce, to me. I don't know how we survived. And in those 6 years, the system had managed to get complete control over my husband, myself, my children, and me in five systems. Rape Crisis Center, that's the Hempstead. That's the one woman that appears that wants to be a friend, that insists, and I think she's normal, but I don't like her. We liked her husband. He was, whose two little boys.
This is Mackenzie.
No, that's London. That's 9 years later. This is her. That's another decade away. This was start. She comes into our life in 2001. We had just had 9/11 happen when we arrived. She pursues us. She had two little blonde boys. She insists on this friendship. We kind of dodged her for a year, but finally caved to it. I was too sick. He was falling over with addiction. Lee Hill had been handing him pills while they kidnapped me and presented him with divorce papers that I'd run off with Aaron Running Hawk. That's when the sorcery really entered. I mean, the people up there were concerned. That my enemies up there were concerned. And this is Pine Ridge. Oh, my God, Leo. I mean, this is the most serious black magic there is. You don't get away from this guy. I was raped and held hostage for 3 weeks by this. It's like something out of one of those movies. This guy, Aaron Running Hawk, he did die about 6 years ago from cancer. He is on that list. And oddly enough, before I've got the phone call from Royce, who was up there when Aaron died, 3 days went by, I hadn't spoken to Royce, and I was walking a dog we had then, visiting some friends down the road, and this crow, this big black crow, appears out of nowhere right above my head. and will not stop. Drove me out of, I finally had to get up and leave work halfway down the road where I'm with two friends I sort of had for a moment there. I think that weren't really friends. Because they stole $6,000. Anyway, this crow actually got me to, you know, come back home, and then it won't, it's at the window. I'm on the second floor here. It was outside for 5 days screaming at me. I couldn't move. I couldn't go anywhere without this crow. Rah, rah. You know, it was just bizarre. But we're used to the bird thing in a good way. And then I get the phone rings. It's Royce. Babe, Running Hawk died. And I said, when? He said, look, just 5 days ago. He used what they call rattle, the rattle of the rattlesnake. The worst, they call it pejuta sapa in Lakota. It's pejuta is medicine, sapa's black. And there was no one on ever in the history of Pine Ridge, and this was never practiced before Columbus, but the dark side of the force, but the CIA started flipping, you know, the most powerful Lakota and indigenous people into black sorcerers in the 30s, 40s, 50s. And they did. And I met the deadly one. You die. My enemies were running up to me in Pine Ridge as I'm trying to escape him and get out of there. Even Royce's ex-wife, who hates me, worried, Lydia, get away. You know, and I'm like, I have no problem getting away. That's where Cornell Conway and Sam Moves Camp ran that kidnapping operation arranged by Lee Hill. Because Lee Hill calls us, tells us, get down to my office right now. This was just before we moved and to Santa Fe. And there he is with one of Royce's best friends. Brother, you know, and there goes Lydia. So, and then Royce is presented with papers already drawn up, which had my forged signature saying, I'm divorcing you for Aaron Running. And he's back here alone. I've disappeared. She's having an affair, Royce. And Lee's up here giving him pills because Royce was the soberest man on earth. Oxys. Let's do this. Oxys, Percocets. I've never seen Royce loaded before that day. And when I got home, and then I never saw him sober again, barely. The last time he was here, we actually had him sober for a year. So that's the occult. And there's where Sophia enters when she's 12 and disappeared into the underworld of pedophilia, prostitution, cannibalism, vampirism. That's her world. That was the world the house was, the underworld criminal world. Everybody we meet are murderers, serial killers, cannibals, dealing human meat, dealing children. We're surrounded. We don't know what to do. And at the last 2 years, I am now under the control, believe it or not, of the Rape Crisis Center, social services, which had kidnapped me and taken the boys, domestic violence system, four levels of different court system that now that I finally sold that house because it went on the market day one, 6 years later, I finally sold it. I couldn't leave. The courts wouldn't let me leave. Domestic violence, rape crisis. They had me, you name it. The systems that had possession of my boys, so they were 18, they were wards of the state, blah, 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 blah. And I don't know, this is where I always escape. And I know that there's so much complexity to my story, and I know it's long-winded, this for some way later time, if anybody wants to ask me how I manage at the moment of life and death, that's what I'm more than willing to share, because the next thing you know, 2006, one of the first buyers that showed up as the housing market is crashing. It already begun in 2007. The house is unsellable. It's unsellable on every level. And I bought it for $450,000. The realtors were telling me you cannot sell it in a 6 year for, $100,000. No way. And two people walk in the door and offer full price. And then I got them into a bidding war with the evil neighbor that was another FBI agent that kidnapped Royce for 3 weeks and that caused the domestic violence incident that landed me in the criminal jail cell of the Santa Fe Hospital, St. Vincent's, with 30-man guard called because I was dangerous to the public and I had just beat myself up and pulled my own hair out. So you're getting the idea. This is any given day for the last 20 years. We come back to this house and then we get, you know, sort of more like the Fargo themed film, you know, we'll get a 10-day thing or, you know, it's a film in itself. And we've had maybe 30 of those in the first 6 years. And the occult stuff coming and going. And with that comes spiritual help to me. And it began in Santa Fe. And I begin to understand it. And I begin to know how to ask for help correctly. See, my husband was Indian. And he was a good man. And he was a full blood. And I, you know, I was. So I. The here we are 10 years into this house, and our last really crazy event out in front of the house was a year ago by two pledged Zionist George Soros agents. The woman that co-founded MoveOn.org arrived at the door with George Soros with her boyfriend, who was really creepy. He had black eyes with no pupils, and he's IDF, especially, he's all over the internet, so I've got links. They're the last two. Since they couldn't get me, they couldn't entrap me, they couldn't, I just smiled at them. You know, they were coming under the guise, now I have a business where I'm renting the downstairs of the house, short-term Airbnb and long-term. And then I start getting these kinds of people under the guise of, we want to come see your house. And they knock at the door and they come into the living room. And I said, where are you guys from? And she says, I'm from San Francisco. And he says, I'm from Jerusalem. And I went, oh, really? How lovely. Because, you know, I've been posting a lot about Zionism in the last few years. And my son has no bones about it. His passion for Palestine that he got from me, that all Indians here share with the Palestinians, also living in an open air prison camp and genocide. So they wanted to go see the downstairs. They got in my face as soon as we got into the apartment and they were up like this. We want you to network with us. We want you, you know, and I played dumb for maybe a half hour. And this is this part of the room. And that's that. I go into auto mode and I'm well trained by them. They trained me. And, oh, I'm sorry, did you hear the joke about the hippie that had the, because this creature called Ray Abalia, you can Google her. She founded Code Pink to torment Iraqi vets. But this is the woman at my house a year ago, February. And she has hair coming out, you know, it was disgusting. So I, you know, while they're trying to recruit me and corner me and terrorize me, I said, have you heard that hippie joke about, you know, the hippie that can't find this? Oh, God, her face turned red, you know. And I managed to get them out and around back of the house and heading toward the car. Thank you so much for looking. Have a nice day. They were pissed. He grabs me, manhandles me, throws me around and says, do you or do you not stand by Palestine? And I went, I'm just standing by the side of my house. That's all I'm doing is that my house. And he wouldn't let go of me. He had me by the. So I'm used to being physically accosted, terrorized, psyops is. And I just, at this point, I call the police on the police. I call the FBI on the FBI. I call the CIA on the police. I've called this successfully many times. I call the police on the CIA. That was a good one. And that, you know, so it's like this. And since they left, they came back the next night with our own private display of crisis actor, 30 vehicles. They're out in front of the house. It's a big 1 acre meadow from the house. And this is my final story to the road we live on, which is rural. They appear About 4 in the afternoon, I can see them from the living room, which is all windows. And they wait and they wait, and they're going back and forth in front of the house for an hour, and they keep stopping at the bottom of the driveway because they really thought that I would come out of the front door. And whatever they had planned, as long as I came out of the front door, that they had me, whatever they were, whatever that meant to them. And the more I didn't, I stood quietly in the living room. I didn't even call the boys this time. For the first hour and a half, watching them fret and fight at the bottom of the driveway, and they're on their cells, off their cells, on their, at my driveway, going back to their broken down car, which wasn't broken down. This went on for about 2.5 hours. Now it's just getting dark. I turn off all the lights. I'm really good at this now. Turn off the lights and watch. So suddenly 30 emergency vehicles, the first cop cars start pulling in, Boulder County. This is rural, in front of our house. Tow trucks, ambulances, on and on, 30 vehicles. I call the police. They get there next morning. The guy, I know which ones are going to be good and not, before they even open their mouths. So this guy, I know it's going to be a problem. And a Boulder County sheriff, and he walks in the door, and he says, Mrs. Whitecalf, I didn't introduce myself. He says, there was no one here last night. There was no vehicles here last night. I said, I didn't tell you there were any yet. But would you like some coffee? Do you take cream and sugar, officer? And then I had this huge black eye because in the dark, I'd been running through the house, and he said, where'd you get that black eye? And I said, well, what I really want to tell you about is how a car tried to drive my 90-year-old mother off a road this morning in Maryland. And as this was happening, there was a friend of mine at the house who left here just before this began, and a car tried to drive her off the road on Magnolia. He was forced to take out his pad. But he had to come back last summer after my daughter tried to kill me, at which point he'd been the one denying in February, there were no, in a, you know, really nasty, brute, bald-headed Hank figure. And, but when he comes back after the daughter episode, he's like, he comes in with another homicide unit guy, and they sit down, and at this point, we became best friends. And he said, Lydia, why do you keep trying to help your daughter? She's 30. You lost her when she was, what is wrong with you? And I said, he said, have you ever considered seeing a therapist? And I said, I am a therapist, and I've been going to me for years, and it hasn't done a damn thing. And then the next thing you know, they're hanging out with us, and he's teaching my youngest son and I really seriously how to kill her and have a jury not find us guilty of murder, which angles, which doors, 3 hours, him and his friend. So a lot of them turn out to be good friends. And the daily stalking is out there to this day. I cannot go out with those dogs and not run into one of four men. 10 years now on this road. And cars and cameras and helicopters. So, you know, I think you get the story. And it's very rare that I get angry. I find flirting is the best, and humor and honesty, and even running up to them and you know, saying, have you heard? And just making something random, wild up. But during this 10 years is also any time Royce goes out, it's a van with two guys that tells him, we're gonna kill you, we're gonna kill Lydia and the boys. All he got was death threats. When I get a death threat, and I've had only a few, I'll say something, I don't know, off the cuff. I don't show them that I'm afraid. I don't know. So that's there's more I could say about the psychology I've used, that I will find flirtation and a charm is, it goes infinite miles. They can get really nasty, you know? So you're frozen. Am I frozen? Have we dropped? Dropped. I don't know where it froze, but I saw you were frozen. Now I can't hear you. Hold on.
Okay, I'm muted. I'm muted myself.
Okay, okay. So, you know, that's, I don't know how long that took and how much over 2 hours I am, but that, I hope I gave the general picture of phase one, phase two, and phase three. The really scary part is the occult part that I know that the Hempstead, we were right in the heart of that kind of thing for, they tried to keep us there for more than the Santa Fe years. They kept trying to bring it back to us here, and it won't work. I pray every day, just as Royce taught me with the day I met him. Actually, I started 2 years before I met him. I already knew what to do, ironically. And that's the real heart of my story with that. It doesn't seem that the electromagnetism can work on me because I'm praying to a specific force that is the real electromagnetism, which I shared with you originally. So that's may sound insane, but it's not. That's the heart of the indigenous cultures, and I'll stay in specific with whose. That's the heart of it. Whether you look at the Bon that mixed in with Tibetan Buddhism, that they were concerned with the thunder. You look around the world, you look throughout history, you research this, you find that there's one principle of power. It's the lightning and the thunder. All the way back through these last 9,000 years, epoch before that, in the alternative archaeology we've seen from Grant Hancock and others in Egypt and the other lost civilizations, it's about lightning and thunder, and that really that and the ability to laugh and never let them win. Never let them get you down. Laugh, love, dance. That's what the boys and I do. We have illegal levels of fun through all, and it's not endless pain. It is. We have suffered, but we've had illegal levels of fun when we're alone in the house, and or alone anywhere throughout all of this. When we're alone, we start laughing, and so that's I don't know why I had that gift, but I do. And that's, if you start taking them seriously, they win right there. If you really, you know, let them get to you, they win. If you let them take your joy and gratitude for this incredible earth and world and beauty and life and each other, meeting you, people like, if you let them take that, they win. And I won't give it to them. I don't care what they've put us through and what my sons are still going through. They can't get it. It doesn't belong to them. It belongs to Creator.
Right.
And yeah. And it's beating here. Beautiful. Yeah.
I think that's really good. Well, we should probably sign off. This has been, what an incredible journey. Podcast one and podcast part two. It's been amazing. Both sections for different reasons.
Yeah.
Very much, Lydia. I think that what you bring to the table here is a real important piece.
Yeah.
And thank you for sharing it with us. And we're going to share it with as many people as we can. I hope people who've watched this all the way through share it on other Facebook, share it on other social medias. And
I might say prepare, because there'll be attack when it comes to me for some reason. It'll get nasty, I assume. You'll get, you know, horrible comments and all kinds of, and bring it on. And you always tell them, and they know that I'll send good prayers for them.
Thanks.
But I'm assuming that'll still happen. Maybe not. If it doesn't, then, you know, it's really over. So we'll see. But thank you, Paul.
Well, I think what you're going through and what the other TIs are going through are previews of what's going to happen to anybody who thinks outside the box. And all of these things are, and how to get through this that we can learn from you and the other TIs is a real important lesson for all of us.
Yeah.
So thank you very much, Lydia. And we'll look forward. We've got a lot more stuff to talk about.
Yeah, I'm excited about that.
Yeah, we'll do more podcasts. So okay. Take care, Lydia.
And thank you. Have a nice day. Thank you.